I always love doing that, standing behind him and him looking, trying to find where I'm at. A couple of Sundays ago when I came to preach, I thought about getting me a box, stand on top of it so I could wave up high like he does, but I didn't do that because I thought I'd fall off the box. That would have been embarrassing, wouldn't it? But I'm a blessed man. Yesterday was my wife's birthday, and I thank God I've had her for another year. Can't explain how much she means to me, but God does because he keeps letting me keep her. Amen. She means a lot to me, but we are blessed to be here tonight. This has been one of the busiest weeks I guess I've had. We had three services Sunday, had two services yesterday. We're here tonight, be at the nursing home in the morning. And then the coming Sunday night, we'll be at Faithway Pentecostal. So that's like eight services this week. And I didn't know what I was asking God when I asked him. Jesus, use me. Lord, don't refuse me. So be careful what you ask. But I don't regret a mile. I don't regret anything I've done for the Lord. And I know I preached last night at the church. I gave my wife a surprise birthday party. But I preached last night at the church, you know, that sin is abounding, and that's not good. You know, sin is abounding, and the love of many is waxing cold, and that's worse. Because you sin and you don't love, that's a bad thing. But tonight, I've been preaching a lot on about standing. And tonight, my thought comes from Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 and 11. I just give them a couple of verses because I use so many scriptures they can't keep up with me. So I just make it simple, just a couple of verses and go from there. But as the pastor said before, our world is in bad shape. It's in terrible shape. And I think a lot of that is because we've forgot how to stand, how to represent and be the church that God wants us to be. So the thought came to my mind today, now is the time to stand. How many of you want to stand? I want to stand because I'm called for a time such as this, and so are you. But if you have your Bibles, you know, the pastor last Wednesday night had a Bible drill. And I don't know how many people had their Bible. I always carry mine. I got mine duct taped. I got paper clips. I got rubber bands. I'm holding it together. I tell folks it brought me this far, and it's going to take me the rest of the way. So I don't know if you got your Bible or not. I tell folks, you know, if you don't have your Bible, it's like going to a picnic without a lunch. It's like going fishing without a pole. And I said, it's almost, you know, it's like getting a Big Mac without special sauce, you know. And I say that kind of funny-like, but it's serious. We need our Bible. We need to know what it says. And but if you have your Bibles tonight, they'll have it on the screen, I'm sure. But Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10 said, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand, that you be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Lord, bless this word, we pray. God, somebody in the house needs this word tonight, Lord. And I pray that all minds will be open, all hearts will be open, everybody be ready to receive this. Lord, I feel there are some here tonight, God, they need you. They've allowed the devil to separate them from you. They've allowed themselves to get in a lukewarm situation. And I know, God, you can bring restoration in their life, those that need it tonight. God, even for us, Lord, we believe that you can bless us tonight. So just bless this word, we pray. Lord, for this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, the Bible talks about the wiles of the devil. You know, the tricks, manipulation, the plots, the schemes that the devil has. But we should know enough about the scripture. That's why I say it's important that we have this word with us. David said, I want to hide these words in my heart that I may not sin against God. Because the devil is full of tricks, and he is manipulating. He's plotting even now, and he's scheming even now against you in this sanctuary. You folks watching by Facebook, he's plotting. He's looking for a way that he can get to you. 1 Peter 5 and 8 said, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. You know, it's about that he walks around sort of casual-like, and and looking around, viewing and checking out people. You know, when Sister Cook and I take trips, a lot of times she likes to go to the mall, not so much now as she did before. And I'd sit down in on a seat and I'd watch people come around. I'm a people watcher. And I'd kind of watch them when they walk by, you know. And I remember one time I was in Atlanta, Georgia. I was flying to Texas and I was sitting there at Atlanta and I saw things I didn't even know existed in the world. And we see that looking around. Well, that's what the devil does. He's looking for things. He's looking for you. He's checking you out and see if you got the goods. But the Bible tells us that we need to be sober and we need to be vigilant. Because he is about seeking whom he may devour. Verse number 10 said that we need to resist him and be steadfast in the faith. Because all of us are challenged. All of us are under attack from the enemy. But we can resist him. The Bible said resist him and he will flee. While we're resisting the devil, that doesn't mean we resist today and surrender tomorrow. We got to understand we got to stand faithful to God and be steadfast in that. But we know at the beginning in Genesis, we find that the devil came through the garden one day. And in Genesis 3:1, he began, the first thing he said to Eve was, he challenged the word and said, did God really say that? Did God, you know, he says that to us. Does God really mean that? Did God really say that? Are you just thinking that to be the fact? Well, when he came to the garden, he spoke to Eve. He said to her, did God really say that? And he began to say, you'll not die. You'll become as gods. And, you know, the devil makes suggestions. And, you know, the problem with us is that we make the decision. That we don't have to do what the devil says. He does come by and he makes decisions. That's why some folks are not in the house of the Lord tonight. Why people quit church. Why people are not about the business of the Lord. But it tells us that Eve made a decision and so did Adam. And what happened was when that decision was made, that it affected all of mankind because of their disobedience. You know, it's terrible when people make decisions that affect other people. You know, we're affected by a lot of things today because of decisions that other people are making. Not of our doing, but we're paying a price because of what they decide they think is right. But if we're not careful, the devil will make suggestions to us. And if we're not where we need to be with God, we'll follow those suggestions. We'll be doing what he says for us to do. Galatians chapter 6, verse 7 said, be not deceived, for God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. Friend, you know, there ain't nobody getting by with nothing. We're all going to stand accountable to God for the life that we do live and the deeds we do, the deeds we don't do. But what he does when he goes around seeking whom he may devour, he is deceiving people, making suggestions. And people, if you're not where you need to be with God, if you're not praying and doing all the things you need to do as a Christian, you'll start taking those suggestions in and you'll be convinced that that ain't so bad after all. Everybody's doing that. When I was growing up, I'd tell my dad, I said, well, everybody's doing it. He said, not everybody, because you ain't going to do it. And that's the way we got to realize that the devil makes a suggestion. But think about this. Is it worth sinning? Is it worth dying, going to hell for? When he makes that suggestion, that is, as a Christian, we ought to be able to understand what the Bible says. But see, people, they're not studying the Bible to know what it says. It's like when you go out and I went to get my driver's test when I was young. I was 16 and I just thought I knew it all. I didn't study the book. I went down and took the test and you know what happened? I flunked because I thought I knew everything. That's what the devil wants us to think, that we know everything. You know, we don't need to look at this Bible. We know everything. Well, we don't know everything. And he challenges us because, you see, what he wants to do is get our mind confused. And a lot of people today are confused because a lot of things going on in the world, they're confused. And when he challenges us, he challenges our faith and he wants to deal with our faith. I tell folks, you know, you think he's after your soul. But he's really after your faith, because if he's got your faith, he's going to get your soul. So he messes with your faith. That's why you have so much going on in your life. And the things that you have to deal with and go through is because he's messing with your faith. He's trying to convince you that God will not do anything for you, that you're wasting your time. When you go to church, you waste your time. When you pray, you waste your time. When you're reading the Bible, it's all in vain. But what you got to understand is that God is feeding us by his Spirit through faith in his word that helps us to be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Like I say, he's manipulating. He's manipulated some of you today. He's deceived you. He's caused you to look in a different direction rather than be looking towards God. He tells us because he understands how faith is. Hebrews 11 and 6 said, teaches us that without faith, we cannot please God. We cannot please God unless we have faith. We got to have faith to believe that he is and that he is a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. Now, in the book of Luke, it tells about when Jesus went into the wilderness. And as the devil comes, as he says, seeking whom he may devour, he comes at that weak time in your life. He don't come when you're strong. He don't come when you're really doing something for God. He sees that time you're getting weak and you're kind of fading away from the house of God, fading away from praying, fading away from the Bible. And he sees when you're getting weak, that's when he shows up. So when Jesus was fasting those 40 days and he was coming out of the wilderness, there was the devil to stand there and to challenge him. But I want to tell you, the devil, he's not very smart, is he? He was testing the Lord when he came out. We know the Bible teaches us that there is power in fasting and in praying. Now, I know some people, prayer and fasting are bad words. But I tell you, as a Christian, you need to learn how to do that. Because he said there in John 14, these things that I do, greater things shall you do. Why? Because we fast, we pray, we get ourselves strong in the Lord and the power of his might, that when the devil comes and the wiles that he does against us, we've got the power in the Lord that we're able to stand and resist the devil and claim victory in Jesus and be able to say, victory today is mine. I told Satan, get thee behind because victory today is mine. Folks, we're supposed to live in victory. There's no reason for anybody to die and go to hell. But you see, the devil convinces people they're not any good. They're not worthwhile. I talked to a gentleman the other day, and he said, I'm just not no good for anybody. I said, well, you're good for God. That's why Jesus came into this world, because you're good for him. You don't have to be good for people, but you can be good for God. And that's what's going to count on judgment day, that you're good for God. You don't have to worry what men think. I learned a long time ago, no matter what your opinion of me doesn't really matter. But I'll tell you, that opinion of me and him really matters, because I want him to be able to say, as I heard a brother say the other day, I want to hear him say, well done, my good and faithful servant. Friend, when I see him face to face, I want to be able to look up and know that heaven's my home and I want to be with the Lord forevermore. But the devil tries to steal this from us. He tries to come against people. And the sad thing is, there's people that sit in church houses time and time again that are allowing the devil to manipulate them and get them convinced they're all right because they go to church. They don't pray, don't read the Bible, they don't do anything that God wants them to do, but they go to church and that's all that matters. Friend, I tell you, a lot of folks can go in church and sit in church and die and be lost without Jesus. But when he came to Jesus, he began to talk to him and he began to challenge him. And you know, the devil, he can be strong, but you know, the strength that he has is a limited strength. Now, I'm not as strong as I used to be. When I was young, I could take a refrigerator and whip it on my back and I could carry it, not very far, but I could carry it. Right now, if I see a refrigerator that needs to be moved, I say, hey, big man, move this for me. You know, I'm not as strong as I used to be physically, but I'm stronger today spiritually than I've ever been, because I practice spiritually every day in my relationship with God, because I know the enemy is after me. I know he's seeking to devour me. I know he's coming in us in so many different ways. And I tell people, like the gentleman the other day, when he said, you know, how can you preach faith and your wife being as sick as she is? I said, I can preach faith because she's still with me. You see, you got to understand what faith will do for you. But when the devil came and he began to challenge the Lord, when he challenged the Lord, you know, the Lord told him, and he used scripture. That's why it's important we read this Bible, what we know, what it says, that we can use scripture against the devil, friend. Because he can't handle the word of God. When he came to Jesus, Jesus quoted the words, said, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God." You see, the devil thought he could challenge him, and he did, but he lost. He went on to say, and said, "Get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord thy God, and only him shall you serve." Boy, he was putting the devil in his place, folks. We got to learn how to put the devil in his place. And how are we going to do that? We're going to do that by the word of God. We're going to do that by faith. We're going to do that by prayer and overcoming him. Because it tells us that if we take on the power of the Lord and the power of his might, that makes us able to withstand the wiles of the devil. Amen. Verse 12 said, "Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God." Yet people are tempting the Lord today. They're tempting and crossing their fingers and their legs and their toes and trying every way, even crossing their arms, and just hoping that everything goes all right. That when they die, that they're going to be ready. Why take the chance? Why take the chance to be ready to die and live in this world and just hope it works out for you when the Lord tells us today is the day of salvation? Friend, we need this Bible. I'm talking to you tonight about this word, that we got to take this word and we need to use this word. That's the only way that we're going to make it through this, because we pray and we study and we look to God by faith and know that he's with us, that no matter where we go, he's going to be right there. He's going to help us to get through there. See, what the devil does, he tries to twist the scriptures. See, that's what he was doing with the Lord here. That's what he was doing with Eve in the garden. He was trying to twist the scriptures. But if you don't know what the scriptures is, you don't know what he's telling the truth or not. Amen. Now, I love pastors. When I go to a church to a pastor, I got this with me. Come on. Why do I got it? Because I tell you, I want to know he's coming out of this book. You know, I went to a church one night and this man opened up books. I'm going to preach out of my book tonight. I looked at my wife and said, "Do we stay or do we go?" I said, "I'm going to preach out of my book." Man, this is the only book I want to hear preached right here. Because men have opinions. They got their own ideas and philosophies and theologies, and they want to use their book. And it may be a good book to read, but it may not be a good book to live by. But you can't get no better book to live by than this book I've got in my hand here tonight. And he tries to mix it up. That's why it goes back to 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15. Says, "Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of God." You know, I get this. I talked to a pastor this morning about 5 o'clock. I was laying in there, I had my Bible open, and I talked to him this morning early. He probably was surprised I was up that early, but I get up early every morning. My wife, I let her rest. I get up, I brought my Bible, you know, and I read my Bible and I pray. On Wednesdays, I have what I call my Wednesday prayer time. I pray every morning, every day, but Wednesday I picked out as a special time of prayer. People give me special prayer requests, and we take special prayer for that every Wednesday. And so I get up in the morning and I'm doing that early, because, you know, when I get up in the morning, I say, "Lord, I want to start my day with you." When my feet hit that floor, I'm ready for battle, because I know the devil's waiting to come around. He's going to check me out, see where I'm at today. I'll be honest with you today, my wife will tell you, I got sicker, if you'll let me use that expression, than a dog today. If God hadn't touched my body, I would have been here tonight. I was a gagging and I was going on and just all that kind of stuff just hit me all at once, and I thought, "Lord, you got to help me. You got to help me." And I began to pray and meditate. And after a while, I went and made me a sandwich and got me a little cake and started feeling better. And I feel better now than I've had in a long time. I couldn't even tell you the way I feel that I was feeling bad today. But God had a word for you tonight. I've got a word from God for you folks sitting in this house. I cannot stress to you the importance of reading this Bible and studying this word and preparing yourself for battle, because the devil is after you. And if you don't know how to defend yourself with the scripture, if you don't know how to defend yourself with faith, if you don't know how to defend yourself with prayer, friend, you need to get back in the book. You need to hit your knees. You begin to pray and talk to God and let God restore you to where you need to be. But we need to study. I tell folks, you know, man got a little upset with me one day when I said this, but we got a bunch of cherry pickers. Anybody know what a cherry picker is? He runs down the end and wants you to throw the ball to him, and all he does is lay it in. And we got a bunch of cherry pickers, preachers today, and people that are searching the Bible for an easy, affirmative way to get to heaven without having to deal with sin. I'm here to tell you tonight, friend, you can't get to heaven without dealing with sin. You've got to ask forgiveness of God. You've got to repent. He said he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Why? Because this book will get you to heaven. You ignore this book, you're taking yourself into jeopardy. Romans 3 and 4 said, let God be true and every man a liar. I know people have opinions and they look at scripture different ways and they'll try to explain why they believe it that way. Friend, you can take this Bible and justify yourself all you want to. But I tell you, God will take this Bible and he'll condemn you for your justification. As a pastor said a while ago, our righteousness is as filthy rags. There's none of us righteous, no, not one. Because we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. I'm here to tell you tonight, God is good. God is good. He's trying to prepare you from heaven. But you're allowing the devil to deceive you, manipulate you, use you, and get you in a way that you're not going to go to heaven because he's got you convinced the way that you're living is going to be all right. I'm here to tell you, friend, if you're not living by the Bible, if you're not living by faith in Jesus above, if you're not trusting in his confiding love, if you are not doing what the Bible says, you're not going to heaven. Amen. You got to understand this. There's a lot of religious diversity in the world today. I tell folks that America is the most diverse religious nation in the world. I don't know how many religions they are, but it's like a Sears and Roebuck catalog. The Christmas edition. They got extras in that. People searching to try to find a way to get to heaven without going by the cross. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh to the Father except that he cometh by me. But I've been by him. I said, I've been by him. And because I've been by him, I know that I'm on my way to heaven. And the journey gets sweeter every day because I've been by there. There's folks today say, I don't need church. Hebrews 10:25 said, forsaking not to assemble yourselves together more so as you see that day approaching. There are people who say, well, I don't need to read my Bible. As I said, 2 Timothy 2:15, study to show thyself approved unto God. Worm needeth not to be ashamed. You see why they can't keep up with me about putting the scriptures up there. Not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of God. Folks said, I don't need to pray. God already knows what I need. Yes, he does. But in Luke 18:1, he said, men are to always to pray. Amen. Friend, you need a prayer life. You need a study life. You need to be in church. Like I say, and I'm not saying it braggingly, I'm just saying the Lord gave me opportunity. I told a man the other day, he said, I'm obligated to my church. And I said, if you're obligated, you're in bondage. Amen. I'm committed. I am not obligated. I don't have to go. I'm not obligated. I go because I'm committed, and I want to go to church. I want to be in God's house. I want to worship with people. I want to help them get to heaven. No, sir, I'm not obligated. I'm committed because he was committed to me to go to that old rugged cross and die, shed his innocent blood. He's sitting on the right hand of the Father making intercession for me and you tonight, and he's coming back one day, and I'm going to heaven to be with him. Thank you, Lord. I'm committed. Friend, listen to me. You know, I thank God I'm saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost. Filled with the Holy Ghost. The Bible said, Acts 1 and 8, you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Then you want power, let's get a hold of that Holy Ghost. I told you a story about my oldest son. You know, he was kind of an inquisitive little boy, always checking into things. And back in those days when he had bobby pins, some of you may not know what they are. But they had bobby pins, and my mama had this long hair, and she had what this thing called a rat. She rolled her hair up on it and kind of put it around her head and looked like a big U. And she had these long bobby pins about that big. But one day we're sitting there, and little Jim, he goes over and picks up one of them bobby pins, and he goes over to a plug, and he sticks that in there. It rolled him right across that floor. Let me tell you what. It shot blisters on the back, on the bottom of his feet. And man, it was years before he'd ever plug a plug in. But he felt something, and he didn't forget it. When I got the Holy Ghost, I felt something, and I haven't forgotten it because it's still with me. I encourage you to get a hold of the Holy Ghost and let it get a hold of you. But we will receive power to become witnesses. Folks, we've let down. on witness. Let down on witness. This past Sunday after we preached, Sister Cook and I stopped to get us a sandwich. And was y'all there? Did I see y'all at that? Wendy's? Sunday before. Okay, that's when I preach. Okay, that's when I preach. Okay, I lose track of time sometimes. But we were in that Wendy's. And there's a little girl there we know, sweet little girl. But she wasn't there on Sundays. But there's a couple of other ladies there, and they begin to ask for prayer. Well, what we do? Say, let's pray. Amen. So we got away from that. Well, I'll pray for you. I'll write you down, and we'll pray for you when we get home. I'm not that way. I'm not. If people need prayer, what are you supposed to do? You pray. If they're needing oxygen, they're having a series of events, and you know CPR and all that, you're going to stand and say, breathe, breathe. No, you're going to go down and do something. That's what I'm. We got to get back to doing something. That's why I'm saying now is the time for us to begin to stand. We got to get back to standing for God and standing for the Bible and standing for family, standing up and doing what God wants us to do in the time that we're living in. Our Jesus is coming. We are to be witness. The Bible said we can pray for the sick. If men are sick among you, let me call for the elders of the church, anointing them with oil for the prayer of faith to save the sick. Man, we got to get back to believing that people get healed. You know, we need to get back. You know, there's devils in this world today. I don't like to talk about the devil. Why not? He's your enemy. The Bible says you have power to cast the devil out. Amen. What's happened, we've got weak. But we've got to stand. I said, we've got to stand. Zechariah 4:6 says, but it's not by power and not by might, but it's by my spirit, saith the Lord. Yes. Friend, we need to get back to standing, representing and being what God wants us as a church to be. We quote 2 Chronicles 7:14 so much, of my people who call by my name. We quote that so much. But what do we do with it? We just quote it. Friend, we want to marry to get back to being what God wants it to be. You want the church to get back to what God wants it to be. If you want to get back to where God wants you to be, it's time that we get back to God. Amen. Back to the Bible. You see, our family needs us today. Amen. Those children the pastor was talking about there. I said this before when I preached here a while back. You know, those children need you. Sometimes we think it's just our children. So train up a child in the way that it should know. Sunday school teachers, youth leaders, pastors, moms and dads. We got a mandate from God. Amen. To train these children. Why is our society and our children so messed up today? Because we have forgotten. Because we have forgotten what the book said. The Bible says, seek the Lord while he may be found. Matthew 6:33 says, seek first the kingdom of God, and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Amen. What is it that you're going to allow the devil to take away from you, to manipulate you? What are you going to do when you know? The Bible says, when a man knoweth to do it's good, and to it's not to him, it is what? It's sin. When you know to do what you need to do, but you let the enemy deceive you, manipulate you, got you on the way to hell. Realize if you took your last breath right now, you know where you would go. But as a Christian, man, we can be rejoicing right now and dancing on the streets of glory in the next heartbeat. You got to think about it. Now is the time to stand. See, the Bible teaches us he's out about, walking about, looking. He's manipulating. He's planning. For even tomorrow, we don't know. Even tomorrow, we don't know. But where are you standing with the Lord right now? Are you ready for heaven? Are you ready for hell? Because you leave here tonight, you're going to make a decision. Now I work at a funeral home. I do about 30. I've done as many as 52 funerals in 1 year. I've had people come up and shake my hand one night and 2 days later go to their house and pick them up and bring them back. Because we think we're going to live forever. Because you're breathing now doesn't mean you're going to breathe tomorrow. What I'm trying to tell you, friend, it's time to get back. It's time to stand. It's time to be ready. Because one day the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout and the voice of the archangel. The dead in Christ are going to rise. The saints which are alive and remain are going to rise up to meet the Lord in the air. Now you're going to go meet the Lord in the air. You're going to be left behind. What I'm trying to tell you tonight is to help you. And that's because I love you. That is because I do what I do for this past 52 years. I've been preaching this gospel. And I'm here to tell you, it hasn't changed. I'm a salvation preacher. I want to see people saved. I want to see people go to heaven. Amen. They'll come to the music tonight. I want you to take time to just bow your heads. Take your inventory. The Bible said, examine yourself to see that you're in the faith. But I've not given you anything but Bible tonight. Psalm says, Jesus has a table spread where the saints of God are fed. He invites his chosen people. Come and dine. You're his chosen people. He's inviting you to come to this altar tonight. If you're not ready for heaven, if you know for a fact right now you're not where you need to be with God, you need to be in this altar. The song says, come into my heart, come into my heart. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Come in today, come in to stay. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. You ask yourself now if you're where you need to be with God. You might have been a Christian for a long, many years. Something has happened to cause you to drift away. But you're not where you need to be with the Lord. Song says, come home, come home. You need to come home. Jesus is reaching out to you here tonight. You folks watching by Facebook, he's reaching out to you. Because you heard the word tonight. He wanted to speak to you. You need to come. You need to come. What is worth dying and going to hell over? What are you willing to give up heaven for? Stand around the building with me. Father, I pray now. Well, I know this message, your word does not return void. I feel here tonight, God, someone needs to come. Need to come to this altar and just have a conversation with you. To bring them back, God, where they need to be with you. Lord, the devil has them deceived. He's got them manipulated. He's doing things that they feel like they're all right. They've gotten that comfortable state, the lukewarm state, that they think everything is all right with them, Lord. But God, you know and they know that what we have preached to them tonight, God, that they would just reach out to you. And I pray as they sing this song tonight, God, they will come to this altar. Lord, they will call upon you to be saved, to be ready for heaven. We have no promise of tomorrow. The day is the day of salvation. God, it's my desire to see everyone saved that leaves this building tonight. Because we never know what tomorrow may hold for us. But God, we do know that you hold tomorrow in the palm of your hand. So Lord, while they sing, I pray. Lord, let those that need to pray tonight, even if, as they're a Christian, I always say, Lord, if you're not saved, come and pray. Even if you're a Christian, come and pray. Because we can't pray enough. We can't talk to God enough. And I open that altar to you tonight with this invitation. Would you come as they sing? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, how we worship you. Yes, Jesus. Help us, God. Speak to them, Lord, right now, God. There's troubled hearts here tonight. God, there's minds tonight, God. There's people tonight. God, they need to come to this altar. Lord, just speaking to them.